I'd like to say a prayer before I get underway here today. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for who you are, for what you've done, for what you're doing, and for what you will do. Lord, we come before you asking for your forgiveness and mercy. We come before you to seek your ways and your righteousness. We ask that you will give us eyes to see beyond our circumstances and situations. We ask that you will give us ears to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying. We ask that you will give us a heart to receive your truth. Yes, let your word be written in our heart that we won't sin against you. Let us go forth and bring you glory. Let us walk in the path of righteousness for your name's sake. For you are holy God, therefore we must be holy. Sanctify us, O God, unto yourself. Lord, let the words that come from my lips are led of the Holy Spirit and glorify you to edify, strengthen, correct, and build up. Yeah, let this place be filled with love and forgiveness, mercy and kindness and joy and peace. Lord, I ask that you will put hedge of protection around us, keep us, strengthen us, heal our sick, feed those who hunger, provide for those who are in need. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Church says, you know, while I was up here, I was just thinking about Pastor Bogle. And those of you familiar with Pastor Bogle, I want you to keep Pastor Bogle in your prayers. Pastor Bogle is the founder of Evangel Ministries. It's the ministries in which I came up through the ranks. And just right now, he was coming to my mind. So I want to be mindful to keep him up in prayer. Amen. Praying for his help and his strength in the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
That being said, today my message is about dry bones in the valley. And it's written by a prophet who was also a priest. His name was Ezekiel. Stories and Bible scholars tell us that Ezekiel was around 25 years old when he was taken into captivity by the Babylonians. Nebuchadnezzar, his father, was a priest. According to the Jewish traditions, a priest would train his son. And once his son get to the age of 30, he would take on that office of ministry. The priest held offices from the time they were 30 to the time they were 50. And at 50, they would have to retire. But even though Ezekiel came into the office of a priest, when he went before the people of God, he was operating in the capacity of a prophet. Because when he was at the age of 30, he was still in captivity of the Babylonians. So he was operating as a prophet. Today, I'm going to dive into the story, but I want to give you some clarification on what's the difference between a prophet and a priest. A prophet goes before the people on behalf of God. The priest goes to God on behalf of the people. A priest goes to God on behalf of the people. A prophet goes to the people on behalf of God. How many of you understand that? Raise your hand and see if everybody walk. Good. Okay, from there, I want you to open your Bibles with me, if you will, to chapter 37 of the book of Ezekiel. Dr. Ferguson read these first four. I'm going to go over these verses again, dive into my text. I'm not going to be long before you. We also have communion today. I was going to wear some different colors, and my wife broke with, "Hey, communion's today." I was like, "Okay, I'm borderline." Got a little red on still. And so I was thankful for that. The reason as follows says, and I'm reading out of King James, it says, "And the hand of the Lord was upon me, and he carried me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley which was full of bones." So he didn't actually visit this place physically. He was carried to this place in the spirit. And he said, "It caused me to pass by them round and about, and behold, there were many in the open valley, and lo, were very, very dry. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. And again he said unto me, prophesy upon these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Prophesy unto these dry bones, speak the word of the Lord. He was given a word to speak. Verse 5 goes on to say, thus said the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause a breath to enter into you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews, that's tendons. If you read out of King James, that's what that means. It says, upon you, and bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and breathe in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. I'll tell you one thing, once you come back from death, you come to recognize who the Lord is. If you've been in the fire, and he gets you out, it's no mystery who did it. Amen? So verse 7, he says, so prophesy as I commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. When I beheld, lo, sinews, the flesh came up upon them, and the skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. And then said he unto me, prophesy unto the wind. That word there can also be rendered spirit. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the spirit, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds of the breath, and breathe upon the slain, that they might live. So I prophesied, and he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood up on their feet, an exceedingly great army. And they said unto me, son of man, these bones out of the whole house of Israel, behold, they say, our bones are dry and our hope is lost, and we are cut off from our parts. Therefore prophesy and say unto them, thus saith the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up out of your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. Let me give you a brief history about Israel. Israel was a very rebellious and sinful nation. Fact. It was an obstinate, stubborn group of people. Their tribes were divided. After Solomon died, the nation split. The 10 tribes went to the north. They went into captivity first, and Benjamin and Judah, the Levites, went to the southern kingdom, and they later went into captivity as well. So this is a divided nation, a sinful nation, was rebellious against the Lord. And if you read the book of Ezekiel, I don't know how many of you have read it, but I want to share some. Chapters 1 through 24 prophesies of the ruins of Jerusalem. Chapters 25 to 32 prophesies of God's judgment on the nearby nations. And chapter 33 is God's last call to them to repent. But chapter 34 through 48, and this is where we at, we in this playhouse, it says, these prophecies concerning the future, the restoration of Israel. So what we're reading about is restoration. When you be come dead and you are brought back to life, you've been restored. As believers in Christ, at one time you were dead in your trespasses and sin. You say, well, how did that relate to dry bones? Dry bones could have been fornication for you. Dry bones could have been abortion. Dry bones could be broken families. Dry bones could be denying Christ. If you deny Christ, you are considered dead. Amen. Spiritually dead. Amen. And so when he says dry bones, he looked at Israel because they were a rebellious group of people, and they had continued over and over to sin. And every time they continued to sin, they fell into captivity. And as long as they was walking the way they were supposed to walk, they ruled. Isn't it amazing how you can weigh up your options? Let me see, do I want to be in charge? Do I want to be the head and not the tail? All you have to do is keep his commandments.
Yep.
Look at your neighbor and say, if you want to live, keep his commandments. Keep his commandments. The prophet said he heard some noise. And when he heard some noise, he noticed that the bones were coming together. And then after the bones came together, the tendons of the bones came together, and then skin went over the bones. And I know some of you are familiar with this passage of scripture, because you might have heard some preachers back in the day say that the foot bone is connected to the ankle bone, and the ankle bone is connected to the leg bone, and the leg bone is connected to the knee, and the knee to the thigh, and the thigh to the hip, and the hip to the spine. But then they were still just bones. But then the Lord had to breathe life into the bones. And then it became a living being again. I don't know if all of you saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost and highly favored, as some of you tell me. But if you don't have the Spirit of the Lord living inside you right now, you like those dry bones in the valley. And when bones dry out, they turn white, and that lets you know that they're done. So if you have denied Jesus, or if you haven't had the opportunity to come to confess Jesus as Lord, you're in the valley of dry bones. And if you want to come out of the valley of dry bones and come in the land of more than enough, into living waters, if you're thirsty on today, the Bible says, as a roe panted after a water brook, so does my soul pant after you. If you're a little thirsty on today, today is the time to come to Jesus. And let me tell you why, because tomorrow is not promised. Yes, look at your neighbor and say, tomorrow's not promised. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but one thing we know, when you're in Christ Jesus, to die in Christ is gain. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, and in his presence is the fullness of joy. And if his Spirit lives inside of you, even if you dead, yet shall you live. This is a rebellious group of people, and I think in this society they become very rebellious as well. This society got so where they say good is bad and bad is good. That's dry bones. Yes, yes, yes. When they tell you to turn left when you should go straight, I say dry bones. When 60% of the population in the metropolitan area is born out of wedlock, I say dry bones. In the valley, when people are raised up in single households and young girls are getting abortions, I say dry bones. In the valley, when they're dropping out of school with no education and no hope, and they're addicted to drugs and robbing and shooting and killing, I say dry bones in the valley. And I say the only hope for a nation like that is the blood of Jesus. And if you deny Jesus, you deny hope. And if you don't know what hope is the expectation of something good coming your way. If you don't have Jesus, you don't have hope. Ezekiel said he heard some shaking. So we need to hear some shaking. Something needs to be stirred up and shook up. Some things need to be turned upside down. We don't need to keep just getting in where we fit in. Hello? We don't always have to conform to the ways of the world. And some things they do is offensive unto the Lord. And if you conform to the world, you're saying no to the Lord. If you say no to the Lord, you saying yes to dry bones in the valley. I don't know about you, but how many of you just want to die and be no more? Raise your hand if you just want to write it off. But how many of you want to live forever without no pain and no sorrow, without worrying about your medication and going through some troubles and some hard times? This is what the Lord has laid out for us. And if we walk around grumpy and moaning and boo-hooing all the time, they go, if you're a Christian, that's what you did, I just keep doing what I'm doing. Some of you done ran people away from coming to church. Who Who said that Pastor Kimbrough said? I'm not scared. Some of us, the way we carry ourselves, it don't look like we even say it. There's no happiness, there's no joy, there's no peace, there's murmuring and complaining. God, before you, you ought to be able to praise his name. If you remember what you used to do and how you are now, you should at least say, thank you, Lord. Because if it had not been for the Lord on our side, we didn't get here because we got some new clothes on. Hello? We got here because of the Lord's mercy. Let me tell you what mercy is. Mercy is when he don't give you what you should get. The other day I showed my son some mercy, partially because my mother was at the house with me. Because if she wouldn't have been there, he would have got dealt with. She's like, hey, no, you know, she always want to get mercy. I'm not so merciful. Everybody's nice enough to say that. But he didn't get what he should have got. And some of you, matter of fact, all of you, didn't get what you should have got. How many know you were dead in trespasses and sin? Your iniquity had went above your head. Is no one here only committed one sin? Is no one here only committed two sins? You have committed thousands of sins. And you know what's weird about this thing about the Lord? Even when he saved you, you still sin. Who said that? Even being saved, you still sin. But he's still merciful. And he promised to keep us even in the midst of a storm. He told us, it's not upon you. I'm the good shepherd. I lay out my life. I give unto the sheep eternal life, and they should never perish. Remember, it is he who keeps you. Without him, you can do nothing. Without him, looks in there and said, you're dry bones in the valley. Dry bones in the valley. Our God is a God of restoration. He restores us. He gives us a new life. Some of us try to still work off of what we used to be. Look at that and say, what you used to be wouldn't much. Leave it. Leave it. We got better things ahead. Quit looking backwards because you trip over what's in front of you. We need to press ahead towards the mark of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. Let yesterday go. Let Joey go. Let Susan go. That's behind you. So back in my heyday, you ain't had no heyday yet. Our heyday is ahead of us, not behind. Our blessings are in front of us, not behind. Our God is waiting ahead of us. He's not behind. And I told you, the good shepherd walks in front of the sheep, not behind. So you need to look ahead for better things. Those that are living bones, who are living testimonies, Jesus lives inside of you. You know, sometimes when you get a flat, you got to pump air into it. But sometimes you still have a hole, and you got to fix that hole. What's good is God fixed the hole so you can hold some air. Because if you don't have a hole fixed, that breath can't stay inside of you. You know, he said he breathed in you and you become a living being. But if there's a hole where it can't hold that thing, it'd be a problem, wouldn't it? It's no point in pumping a tire and filling it up and there's a hole on the other side. The hole must repair. Guess what that hole is in your life? Sin. If the sin is not fixed, your tire can't hold no air. So who said that? We got on tires now. We went from bones to tires. Any kind of way I can get you to understand the goodness of God, and without him you're nothing. Without him you can do nothing. You can be nothing. Your days is numbered. You're the temporary. You give up the eternal. Without him you are dry bones in the valley. And when you hear a story about dry bones in the valley, it's referring to Jerusalem. And Jerusalem is one of the lowest places on the face of the earth. The Dead Sea is 1,300 feet below sea level.
When they say the valley, they mean the valley.
We thought it was a big deal when we went down to New Orleans to deal with the when the levee broke, because it was a few feet below sea level. Yeah, Hurricane Katrina. Matter of fact, Pastor Carr was with us. It was something else on that bus for 19 hours. I'll tell you that. I couldn't wait to get out to testify. But that little area right there is nowhere near as low as it is in Jerusalem. The valley is low. And that's where those dead bones are. It's also a reference to when armies would attack other countries and nations. They would kill so many of them, they wouldn't have time to bury them. And so they would just let those bodies stay out and just eventually just turn to bones. And the older those bodies were laid out there, the whiter those bones became, because they didn't have enough men or time to bury them. So they would just pile them up so you could see the devastation. That's how we were when Christ came and saved you. He was devastated in sin. How many of you sinned before? Raise your hand. And some of y'all looking so good today, you can't even tell you was a sinner. You're looking so special today. Now, I don't know if it's the summer, but some of you look like you've been saved all your life. Have you been saved all your life? If you raise your hand up, you just say, liar, liar, and your pants on fire. There's nobody been saved all your life over here. Hello? So the point I'm making to you is this here. The fact sheet was Israel was supposed to be God's chosen people, and they were. But they also was a stiff-necked or rebellious people. The fact is, God blessed them, gave them the promised land, and they still act up. Sound familiar? How you can testify the Lord bless you with something, sometimes you still act up? How many of you finish acting up? Raise your hand, please. Just checking to see if you're paying attention. If your hand would have went out, isn't it good to know that God is a forgiver? And that he restores, that he heals up, that he edifies, that he can quicken the dead and make you alive. Isn't it good to know if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things pass away, and behold, all things are new. I got a God that loves me, and he said he'd keep me to himself. We are the sheep of his pasture. He is the shepherd that laid his life down for us. And I'm going to share this in closing. God loved us so much, he sent his only begotten. So some of you might think you don't mean that much. You might not have as much money in the bank as you desire, or you might not live in an ideal place that you know your heart desire. But God loved you enough to send his best. So you have to be worth something, because if you're not worth much, he won't send much to get you. But since he sent his best, you need to put your head up. You need to quit walking over with your face down and your back bent over. You're not a slave anymore. Hello? Not to the enemy, but you're a slave to the Lord. When the Bible speaks and tells you that you're a servant, if you look that word up, in Hebrew, it's going to render slave. And sometimes brothers have a problem hearing that word slave. It don't sit well with us. But if you're a slave to the Lord, let it be well with your soul. Because he's the master and he takes care of his. So Ezekiel said he heard some noise and some shaking. Look at your neighbor, says, time for some shaking. Some things that are dead need to be made alive. Yes, we got some problems that's been killing us. We need to speak to those problems and tell them something. The Lord is for me. Look at your neighbor and say, tell your problems, the Lord is for me. And if your problems still stay there, throw this one at it. But this I know, that thou favorest me because my enemies don't triumph over me. You might want to run away, but you know, I haven't lost nothing. Why? Because I don't lose in Christ. You can't get me. You can't snatch me out of his hands. You can't take away my future. Why? Because he is the author and the finisher of my faith. You can't break me. Why? Because great is he that's inside of me than he that's in the world. You
stand there against you. I can't be sick too long. Why? Because he'll heal me. I can't be in trouble too long. Why? Because he'll give me peace. I can't be thirsty too long. Why? Because he'll give me drink. Yes, because he loves me. Yes, that's the kind of God we serve. Everything we face with is temporary. Look, your neighbor says, sometimes you just got to sit down and let the fool go right past you. Look at your neighbor. Sometimes you have to let a fool go right past you. Don't always be so quick to run and engage some stuff. Sometimes you got to let those problems go past you. Sometimes you need to let the sorrows go right past you. Quit fighting sorrows into your house. God, we was talking about dry bones. Dry bones is something dead. But we got a God that quickens the dead. Makes alive. I'm alive. I'm not who I used to be. Is there any in here who been dead who wants to be alive? When I say you've been dead because you have denied Jesus, but on this day, you want to come and confess him as Lord so you can be quickened, so you can be made new, so your sins can be washed away as far as the east is from the west. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Sometimes you just need to just praise the Lord. Even if you don't know what's going on, you can still stand, you can still talk, you can still see, you can still shout, you still got some joy, you still got some peace. You better praise him. Why you still waiting? He said, if you stop him from praising me, the stones will cry out. Oh. Somebody might want to get saved just today. Somebody might want to come to Jesus today. Somebody. You might draw somebody. Somebody might want to come and join the church today. The doors of the church are open. Somebody may be looking for a church home. Somebody might want to be cared for and nurtured and loved and go back there and get some food to eat and sing some songs. Somebody might want to walk into fellowship with that. Doors of the church are open. God is good. He's an all-time God. Yes, he is. He is a faithful God. Yes, he is. He's the keeper of my soul. Yes, he is. He never sleeps nor slumber. He's always hope. I can call him 24/7. Oh, somebody, you got to learn how to praise the Lord, too. Some of you praise the Lord with a little finger. You ain't been through much just yet. When you can almost lost your mind, you know how to pray. But when you've been a dope fiend and a homeless, you can learn how to praise the Lord. But don't take all of you. You know something about the road. When death been close and he has spared your life, we don't got to tell you to shout and praise the Lord. When we're dead, he has quickened us and made us alive. We were dry bones in the valley, but he said, speak to them. And he spoke life into us. Oh yeah, the foot bone to the ankle bone. The ankle bone to the leg. And the leg to the knee. And the knee to the thigh. The thigh to the hip. And the hip to the back. The back to the neck. And the neck to the head. Breathe in us, almighty God. The breath of life that we may live. I ask the Lord to breathe into those who are unbelievers on today that they may live. Draw them unto yourself. Come up here now, you can still be saved. You don't have to come to the altar to be saved. I'm like working out with you in your car. Hallelujah. Let's just give the Lord some praise. We're going to take communion, but let's just praise the Lord. Let's just give the Lord some praise. Let's give him a thanks that we not dry bones anymore. Let's give him some thanks because he loved us. He watches over us. Let's thank him that we got houses to go to and food to eat, cars to drive, money in the bank, that he loves us, that we got kids graduating from school, becoming doctors and lawyers and judges. Listen to the Lord. Everybody don't get to do those things. But if you ever take it for granted, because because he can always take some away from you. Praise him while you still got oxygen. Hallelujah.